This week on the Pressure Cast, Call of Duty is heading back to World War II, Mad Catz declares bankruptcy, and StarCraft gets remastered. It's Monday, April 3rd, 2017. Everything happening in the world of video games is here, now, on the Pressure Cast. Hey, hey, Pressure Pals, welcome to the 175th episode of the Pressure Cast, Video Games Are Dumb.com's weekly news panic that posts every single Monday on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, TuneIn Radio, Google Play Music, and America's longest-running independent newspaper at shepherdexpress.com. My name is Colin Tanner, and I'm caffeinated, so caffeinated, and ready to ramble to you about some goddamn video games. But in case you never listened to the Pressure Cast before, each week the Pressure Cast gathers up all the latest video game news, past, present, and future, and slices it up into several sensational segments and jams it right in your ears in 2 hours or less. If you want to contact the Pressure Cast, it's easy. All you got to do is email pressurecast@gmail.com. You can tweet at VGADumb, which stands for at Video Games Are Dumb, or you can call or text 954-947-7377 to have your voicemail heard on air or your text message read on the show. Man, what a week. We are just a few days away from the Midwest Gaming Classic. And in case you don't know what that is, every year I go to this event, and it is a hotbed of independent developers and really video game veterans, true icons of the industry. If you don't believe me, go check out the VGAD interviews playlist at youtube.com/videogamesaredumb. I'm going back again this year. I'm bringing a camera. I got my microphone. I'm going to be interviewing a bunch of people. I'm probably actually going to be doing an episode of the Pressure Cast with the guys from Portables of Doom. So we'll have new faces on the show next week. I'm so hyped for that. But, you know, that's going to be next week. But look forward to it, because we're going to have a ton of interviews. I hope. Cross your fingers. But we have to deal with what's happening now, not what's going to happen later. So let's get on the train. Chug-a-chug-chug-chug. Here comes the train. Tooty-toot-toot. Beep, beep. That's right, it's time for the hype train. Feel the PR vibrations as we barrel towards Video Game Satisfaction Station on the hype train. This is the part of the show we talk about all those upcoming video games and events to get you hyped up to spend all your money and become a video game guru. And man, we are going to have to talk about Destiny 2. Talked a little bit about last week. We're going to talk more about that right now. Following a leaked poster earlier this month and years of speculation, Activision and Bungie formally announced Destiny 2 earlier this week. According to the post on their website, the story is centered around, quote, humanity's last safe city has fallen to an overwhelming invasion force led by Gaul. I think it's Gaul. I really don't remember what they called the main villain of Destiny, the imposing commander of the brutal Red Legion. He has stripped the city's guardians of their powers and forced the survivors to flee. You will venture to the mysterious unexplored worlds of our solar system to discover an arsenal of weapons and devastating new combat abilities. To defeat the Red Legion and confront Gaul, you must reunite humanity's scattered heroes, stand together, and fight back to reclaim our home, end quote. Long story short, what that means is you're not going to be able to carry over any of your stuff. If you had, progression or weapons or gear, that's not carrying over into Destiny 2. They already confirmed that a while ago, but they have a narrative explanation for that. Activision also released a pre-rendered trailer on Tuesday before having a formal trailer on Thursday. Basically on Tuesday, it was kind of like, hey, come back Thursday for like the real trailer, man. This Tuesday trailer where it's, you know, Nathan Fillion talking inside of a bar, that's not the real trailer. Come back on Thursday. We're really going to show you what this game is all about. And that trailer was also pre-rendered. But it did give us a brief glimpse into the game's comedic tones and a little bit of the backstory. While there was no in-game footage, Bungie said they will debut actual gameplay on a livestream event on May 18th, so look forward to that. Unlike the original Destiny 2, this game is actually going to launch on PC alongside the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. This marks the first time a Bungie-developed game will be launching on PC since Halo 2 way back in 2007. So that's kind of remarkable. It's been about 10 years, and I believe this is the very first time that a Bungie property is launching simultaneously on PC and consoles ever. They've never done that. They used to launch things exclusively on computers, like Marathon back on the Macintosh, and then they went strictly console for, you know, the Xbox, and even, you know, the original Destiny, that was, oh, wait a minute, maybe Oni. Oni on the PlayStation 2. Bungie made a game called Oni. Maybe that launched on PC the same day. I'm not really sure. I'll look into that. But those looking to pre-order will have three options available, from the standard base game to the $100 limited edition, including the season pass, steelbook, and digital items, or the $250 collector's edition, including an additional solar panel, USB charger, laptop sleeve, messenger bag, and a solar blanket. Because who doesn't need a solar blanket? Actually, I don't know what a solar blanket is, and if you do, please leave a comment below on this YouTube page or email me and I will read it next week. I want to know what a solar blanket is. Is that just like a blanket that if the sun touches it, it warms? Isn't that all blankets? I don't know. Activision also confirmed there will be a beta some point in the near future, though no exact release date was given, and that the PlayStation 4 will have exclusive content up until fall of 2018. In related news, Bungie has confirmed it will continue to support servers for the original games indefinitely. They did not say they're going to be shutting down the servers. Destiny 2 will launch on September 8th on the PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and PC. So, they released that trailer on Tuesday, which was just Nathan Fillion in a bar talking, and then it revealed that he was talking to some, like, janitor robot. It was supposed to be funny. Some people thought it was hilarious. I thought it was, like, whatever. But then on Thursday, they launched this, I guess you could call it, like, a cinematic trailer, you know, really giving into the backstory. And I couldn't help, while I was watching it, I just kept thinking, there's something so familiar about this. There's something so, I don't know, rushed about this. And you know, last week, we saw that there was that poster for Destiny 2 that got leaked. It had the release date. It even mentioned that there was going to be a beta that was upcoming. And that really got, you know, the word spread. And then out of nowhere, they're just like, oh, here's two trailers for Destiny 2. So I really wonder if that was, you know, Activision and Bungie's plan all along to announce the game at the end of March, beginning of April. It just seems like an odd time to do that. Or if the leak forced Activision to step out in front of that, because they would much rather control the narrative for this game, control the story of this game, you know, because if it's just like, it's hard to explain, but if you have too many leaks for a game, by the time it gets announced, you'll get like a little bit of excitement, but then it tapers off, you know, and I think maybe Activision Bungie stepped out in front and said, no, we want to make sure that we dole out the information for this game, almost in a way to discourage leaks. I don't know, because like now they have their own timetable that they're dealing with, but that's all just a guess. I really can't tell. I'm sure they had a plan just in case the game leaked ahead of time, because in 2017 you have to have that plan if it's a major AAA game, and I'm sure Activision you know, is that type of publisher to do that. But in case you haven't seen the, I guess, real cinematic trailer, it's basically two narrators. They're from the original game. I have no idea who they are because I never really paid attention to the characters. You've got Nathan Fillion on one side. You've got some blue guy on the other side, and they're filling us in on the backstory. One is being really stoic, you know, I'm being like, my guardians, and then you got Nathan Fillion, who's like, yeah, but whatever, guys, it's all about the loot, 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 come on, gamers, and I have to say, this trailer is one of the worst trailers I've ever seen for, like, an announcement of a game, one of the worst, bar none. It was so obnoxious to just sit there and try and figure out what the hell was going on. I mean, they hit all the points of where the story is, and you had to watch it a few times to be like, oh, okay, so everything's getting blown up, and now they're having to reunite, and it's going to be taking place in more urban environments, I guess, because there was like an actual more realistic kind of rustic-looking city. I guess it's say more like a village, almost like an Italian villa, in a way, is what it looks like. But while I'm trying to pay attention to this, it just keeps going back to this sarcastic dude. You know, on one end, you've got this guy that's like, we lost good guardians in this war. And on the other side, you got Nathan Fillion, who's like, yeah, but who cares? It's all about loot and LOL and skateboarding. And I'm watching this, like I said, trying to figure out, why is this so familiar? And I realized this is not a traditional reveal trailer. It does not even feel like one. This feels like one of those advertisements that some sort of, trailer production house produces exclusively for GameStop. And if you've been to GameStop, I don't know, in the past like 2 years, even 3 years, everywhere else, you'll see a very specific type of trailer, you know, that talks about the game's story and maybe it's more serious. And then GameStop has these weird exclusive ones that are just kind of like, yeah, the story doesn't matter. You gamers are all about the gameplay. Here you go. And we're going to be kind of sarcastic, like, whoa, this is a scary game about zombies, but our trailer at GameStop is like, I bonked a zombie on the head with like an inflatable hammer. What? What's that about? You know what I mean? I hate those goddamn trailers. But I get why they do them, because they're not for me. They're for some 14-year-old that's going to be like, "Oh, that looks cool." That's kind of funny, because you know 14-year-olds have no sense of humor. You know, whatever. But no, the trailer was terrible. It was absolutely terrible. And I really believe that maybe, just maybe, this is a conspiracy theory, and we're going to have two conspiracy theories this episode. Part of me thinks that the leaked poster from LEGA last week forced Activision to get out in front of this, and they're like, well, what do we have? What can we show? Well, we got this GameStop one. Okay, great. Because they want to control the PR messaging, and, you know, whatever. But I get it. I get why they did this. I get why they went with this tone. They're trying to... If you're a hardcore Destiny fan, you're just going to walk away from this thinking, fine, perfect. I want to play it this fall, looking forward to the game. And if you're not a Destiny fan, who maybe thought it was a little bit too serious, because the first game is really dry from a narrative standpoint. They try and crack jokes, but for the most part, it's very self-serious. I guess they're going after a different audience. Whatever. Fine. Anyway, toot toot. In similar news, another popular Activision shooter sequel may have leaked. Last week, the Family Video Gamers website posted several photos of what appears to be a steelbook case for this year's Call of Duty, which, if real, will take place in World War II with the title Call of Duty WW2. Now, video game website Eurogamer is also reporting confirmation from unnamed inside sources. This would mark the first Call of Duty to take place in World War II since 2008's World at War. Earlier this year, Activision hinted this year's entry would see the franchise return to its roots, though they didn't specify what that means. Whatever the case, Call of Duty will likely launch sometime this fall and is being developed by Sledgehammer Games. The last game that they worked on was Advanced Warfare in 2014. We're going to talk about World War II in just a minute. We're going to talk about World War II. Should Call of Duty go back to World War II? But I want to just take a moment here and just discuss something that's been bothering me about this story and about the Destiny story. So the Destiny poster was leaked by an Italian website called LEGA. How many of you know anything about LEGA? Have you ever heard about LEGA? No? Not at all? And before you go, well, of course I have it. I don't speak Italian. We hear things from Japanese publications all the time. We know of Japanese publications. If I said something like Famitsu gave a game a 10 out of 10, you would have probably a basic understanding that Famitsu is that Japanese magazine that reviews games and stuff like that. LEGA, I have never heard of LEGA. The Family Gaming Channel, I have never heard of them at all. And I'm not disparaging them. Hey, everybody's trying to get a piece of the action when it comes to covering video games. I understand that. But let me get this right. Family Gaming Channel and LEGA, they both have Activision major titles leaked. How? How did these two channels, more so than anyone else, more so than GameSpot, more so than IGN, more so than Kotaku? Kotaku is does a great job of leaking of these things. You know, they leaked Activision and other titles that actually got them blacklisted from reviewing games. That's what Kotaku does. So to have these two random websites just be like, oh, we just discovered the two of the biggest titles coming out this fall. Really? And this is why I'm talking about a little bit of a conspiracy theory here, all right? And I could be totally wrong. I might sound like a jackass, and most of the time I do. But doesn't it seem that if you were over in Activision, right, and you're in Activision marketing right now, right? And you're like, well, how are we going to do this? How are we going to handle marketing for this game? Well, why don't we just, you know, leak some of our own information to these smaller sites and create a viral marketing campaign? Because viral marketing is that thing that, you know, people that are in PR, they're just dying for. They want to see some viral marketing, being like, look at this groundswell for this product. But it's very difficult to do these days. If I was over at Activision and I had the opportunity to either create some sort of fake, phony website to get people intrigued about the story of Destiny or intrigued about the story of Call of Duty World War II, or I could just leak a poster and a steel bookcase to two random outlets and have the story be equally big, if not bigger, so when the announcement does come with Destiny, people are even more excited because they heard about this. You know, there's whispers in the air that this is coming. I think that is a brilliant strategy. Does that mean that they actually did that? No, but it's weird, right? And they're both from Activision, and they're both a week apart. It's just incredibly strange. I don't know. Let me know if you think I'm being crazy. I mean, about this specifically. Not saying that this is actually true, I'm just saying it would be really smart. But anyway, I think it's safe to say that everyone's a bit tired of the futuristic Call of Duty games. Not that people don't want first-person shooters in space with double jumps and laser guns, but I think when people pick up a Call of Duty title, they have an expectation that there is going to be some element of reality. It's going to be grounded somewhat, as opposed to going into outer space or wall running or having giant mechanized suits. So in that regard, World War II would be the perfect follow-up to that futuristic trilogy. And I think it's important to point out that the futuristic elements were kind of part of a trilogy, if you think about it, because you had Advanced Warfare, Black Ops 3, and then, Future Warfare, Infinite Warfare. I couldn't even remember the name of it. And yeah, they did some future stuff before with Black Ops 2, but in between that, they had Call of Duty Ghosts, and that is, it takes place in the future, but I wouldn't necessarily call it like a super futuristic game. So people seem to be a bit bored by that. This is a great answer. Going back to World War II, especially because unlike modern conflicts, there's really a black and white element to it. Obviously you could say that the citizens of Germany greatly suffered, but almost everyone, despite what you've read on Twitter, hates Nazis. No one wants to put up with a fucking Nazi. So if you can go back to World War II and shoot a goddamn Nazi, who doesn't want to do that? And this is also probably why they will not actually touch upon the Pacific War, because that got a bit nuclear before it ended. But if Call of Duty is really going back to its roots, I hope they do take cues from the original Call of Duty. Way back in, I want to say it was 2004, 2005, there was the original Call of Duty with, I forget their name, Jason West and Vince Zampella. They were the guys that started Call of Duty, and they had a real vision for how to communicate World War II. The game jumped around in perspectives. Where you would be a Russian soldier and an American soldier and a British soldier. There's a point where you're a Russian soldier, you're running into this horrific battlefield, and you realize you don't have a gun. You got pushed out and you don't even have a gun, which sounds stupid, but that actually happened back in World War II. So I think if they're going to go back here, they really need to have an element of realism, like really take cues from those insane stories that you hear about, and try and navigate between maybe some of the more iconic moments of World War II that we've seen in films and other games, and try and come up with something that's slightly original. I think Battlefield 1, even though that's World War I, shows that there's still so much you can do with this time period. And, you know, with World War II, it seems like it's finally getting to be a little less sensitive right now. People are finally kind of accepting that World War II is, part of pulp culture as much as it is history at this point. But I also wonder, what exactly is Activision planning right now with their other studios? Is it really just going to be a World War II game and then we're going to be going back to outer space next year? Is that what's going to happen? Or will they try to sort of collaborate into some sort of trilogy, like, okay, this year's World War II and then next year maybe go to the Korean War? I don't think I've ever played a video game that takes place in the Korean War. That would be really exciting. And then maybe they could have some DLC where you can get some of the actors from MASH, you know, talking to you in the multiplayer. You know, like, you got a kill streak, you know, or something like that. UAV's online. I don't know what the people from MASH sound like. And then maybe, 2 years from now, maybe we'll get a Vietnam game and they can get Oliver Stone to do a voice pack. We'll talk to you about 9/11 conspiracy theories. It's a possibility. I think that would be really smart. Or I guess they could sort of pull a Clint Eastwood and do sort of like a letters from Iwo Jima and Flags of Our Fathers and have you know, maybe this is just one element of World War II, and then the next year it's another side of World War II, and it just bounces around like that. Either way, you know, I hope they nail this, because while I enjoyed Infinite Warfare, I didn't really dig that single player. It felt a little too wishy-washy. There weren't really... I think when you add a historical perspective, you know, something that actually happened, you can kind of get away with more in a story, because you already have the context. Like, everyone knows what World War II is. So I think if they would be able to perform better from a narrative standpoint with something that's really familiar. Anyway, toot toot. Moving on to Xbox news, Microsoft has added 3 new backwards compatible games for the Xbox One. They are Army of Two, Soltrio Solitaire, I guess, and Far Cry 3. This is actually a really great week, solely based around a single title. To be clear, Army of Two was not a good game. It wasn't back then. It's not a great game now. Solitaire, I will admit, is a great game, but do you really need to play it on your Xbox One? Probably not. Just pick up your phone and download a variety of free Solitaire games, or just go on your computer. Use your mouse and keyboard, be kind of old school about Solitaire. Far Cry 3, on the other hand, is bar none the best Far Cry game to date. That's not to say that Far Cry Primal wasn't awesome. I like Far Cry Primal. Far Cry 4, also a good game. And yes, Far Cry 3 doesn't have all those crazy options that you would see in the later games, but for my money, Far Cry 3 is the most polished, tight experience ever produced for Far Cry. And you know, if you're watching this and you don't have an Xbox, if you have a PC, it still looks amazing. If you have a PC, I'm not sure it'll look fantastic on your Xbox One, no matter what they do, because it's an Xbox 360 game from 2013. That's when PC was drastically outpacing consoles. But if you want to play just an amazing open world experience with a really cool story, I don't want to really spoil the story, but there's a lot of elements to it that just kind of make you go, huh, this is weird. You know, the story kind of makes you uncomfortable if you think about it. And on top of that, it's just so much fun to hunt, and it's just a beautiful island, and there's some really good villains in the game. I don't know. Check it out. It's great. Far Cry 3 on the Xbox One right now. Toot toot. Moving on to Sony news, the PlayStation Plus free games for April have been revealed. On the PlayStation 4, you will get 10 Second Ninja, Curses and Chaos, Drawn to Death, Lovers in a Dangerous Space-Time. On the PlayStation 3, you will get Invisibles, The Lost Kingdom, Alien Rage, Extended Edition, and on the Vita, you will get 10 Second Ninja and Curses and Chaos, because they, of course, are cross-buy. Worth noting that Drawn to Death is actually a new title and was directed by David Jaffe, who was the creator behind Twisted Metal and God of War, which is pretty damn cool. I gotta say, altogether, this is a pretty okay month. Curses and Chaos looks like a neat little pixel art Bush Rush game with a Ghouls and Ghosts vibe. 10 Second Ninja looks like a Super Meat Boy clone with a little bit of combat. Alien Rage might be a okay first-person shooter. It looks kind of dated, but that's on the PlayStation 3 if you want to check that out. I'm actually just really curious to see how Drawn to Death turns out, because like I said, I did play the beta way back, and I just did not really like that game. It just didn't really work for me, and I don't know. Maybe I'll give it another chance, you know, when it comes out, even though there'll be plenty of other things to play, including Persona 5, which I'm really focused on. It's still not a AAA extravaganza, but Games with Gold is still pretty alright when it comes to a lineup, you know? Anyway, toot toot. Moving on to Nintendo, it appears the Nintendo Switch might receive a port of the popular multiplayer game Rocket League. In an interview with IGN, developer Cynox's Jeremy Dunham stated, quote, "Just like all other platforms, we are evaluating it. We are looking to see what the technical requirements are. Luckily, the platform has only been out for a month, so we have plenty of time to look and see how it's doing and what our audience wants," end quote. Rocket League was released on the PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and PC in 2015 and has been continuously populated over the past 2 years with over 10 million copies sold. In case you don't know, I really like Rocket League. I love Rocket League. Now, I haven't kept up with it since the beginning of the year, but I've sunk dozens, maybe hundreds of hours into it on the PlayStation 4 version. I'd love to see it come to the Nintendo Switch, but I'm not sure how good it would actually be. Rocket League had major screen tearing and frame rate issues when it launched on the PlayStation 4 back in 2015, and that's a far more powerful console than the Nintendo Switch. I'm just concerned it would look terrible and it would have a bad frame rate. And that might seem acceptable, you know, given the circumstances, but I don't want to play a watered-down 720p, you know, 30 frames per second rendition of a two-year-old game, even though I love Rocket League. If it could be as good as the PlayStation 4 version, I would probably be up for it. But, yeah, I don't know. Not really my thing. Toot toot. One of the most enduring real-time strategy games is receiving a major enhancement. Last week, Blizzard officially announced StarCraft Remastered, a remake of the classic 1998 title. Yes, really, 19 years old, with 3D models, a full 4K high-definition display, and all of the expansions, including Brood War. In a press release, Blizzard CEO Mike Morhan explained their motivation for the project. Quote, StarCraft is a pure distillation of Blizzard's DNA, its story, its balance, and all of the little details reflect our long-running commitment to epic entertainment. And it's been a staple in competitive gaming and esports for almost 20 years. With StarCraft Remastered, we're modernizing the original game's visuals, audios, and online support to ensure players can enjoy StarCraft for another 20 years and beyond, end quote. Following this news, Blizzard formally made the original StarCraft, the original, way back from 1998, free to download. So if you want a copy of that, you can just go to Blizzard.com and get one. StarCraft is one of the most culturally significant video games of all time. While we still play it to this day, here and there, over in South Korea, it laid the groundwork for esports and is played daily by a lot of players. StarCraft II was released in the fall of 2013 to healthy sales and populated servers, though the competitive scene remains eclipsed by the original game to this day. StarCraft Remastered will launch on the PC and Macintosh, yes really, later this summer. This might seem like standard video game news, popular old game gets new release, big deal, but this is actually about maintaining business. It might sound strange, but Brood War, which is an expansion from the original StarCraft, is still huge in Korea. I mean, huge. It is treated like a true sport. It is like soccer, or basketball, or football, or whatever. That's how much they love StarCraft. There are professional StarCraft players who were, I don't know, maybe 1, maybe 2 years old when the game originally came out. And there's even, you know, people that are trying to get into the pro scene of StarCraft that weren't even alive when StarCraft came out. That's incredible. So it's clear the audience isn't going away, at least not yet, but it's important for Blizzard to at least try to, you know, update it somewhat. To at least the standards of the past decade. I've heard people have a lot of trouble trying to play StarCraft on their very powerful PCs right now because there's just a lot of, you know, it's searching for things that aren't in PCs anymore. You know, it's trying to access certain hardware elements that just aren't there and there's too much power, and it can be kind of a headache setting up a 18-year-old game, you know, on your, or 19-year-old game on your PC in 2017. So now we're actually getting native widescreen. And for the record, I just want to point this out. Like I said, South Korea really loves StarCraft, right? But there's this weird rumor that StarCraft is the national sport of South Korea. That is not true. Taekwondo. Taekwondo is the national sport over in Korea. Get it right. Okay? Great. Good news for MMO fans. Square Enix revealed earlier this week that Final Fantasy XIV will receive an indefinite free trial. Previously, players were able to try out the game for a 14-day trial before requiring a monthly subscription. Now users will be able to play as much as they like, though their character will not be able to progress beyond level 35. Later this June, Final Fantasy XIV is receiving a major expansion called Stormblood, which will raise the level cap from 60 to 70. However, this will coincide with the end of the PlayStation 3 version of the game. And that's basically the whole story. Though I do want to say, this is an incredibly smart move for Square Enix. It guarantees that their player base is going to increase. Even if the players are only free to play, the player base is going to increase, which is going to encourage players that actually pay for the game to stick around, because populated servers are good for everyone. And why wouldn't you want to play it? I mean, if you have a PC or PlayStation 4, you can check it out for free. Why not? You get to set up your character, run around a little bit, see if the game is for you, and then if you like it, you can continue playing it, and if you don't, you can just bounce out. Doesn't hurt anybody. But, I mean, if you don't like MMOs, and you like Final Fantasy, you're probably still not going to like this. I did play the Final Fantasy beta when they were relaunching the game, and I wasn't really all that into it. But Stormblood actually looks to be a huge improvement over the current version. If nothing else, the graphics are a lot better, reason being that they are finally cutting out that PlayStation 3 version. They don't have to support that platform anymore. They can do pretty much whatever they want with the graphics on the PlayStation 4 and the PC. It's kind of funny, though. I was thinking about this the other day. There were all of these news stories and rumors for years that MMOs were going to be coming to consoles. And that was like the one thing everybody wanted. When are MMOs going to be coming to home consoles? And they did. A long time ago. Like Final Fantasy 11. And then obviously Elder Scrolls Online and now this. And no one made a big deal about it. It's just weird. Everybody wanted this for years and now no one cares. Anyway, toot toot. And lastly, in the hype train, the creator behind DayZ, Dean Hall, has finally debuted his latest project. Stationeers is a multiplayer game centered around building space stations in zero-gravity environments. According to the game's official Steam page, quote, construct and manage your own space station either by yourself or in single-player with friends online. Fully functioning atmospheric science, power, engineering. You can tell that I never read the word atmospherics. That's a new one for me. Power engineering, medical, and agricultural systems. Explore to find asteroids and construct elaborate factories to harvest your resources, end quote. No release date has been given, though it will launch on Steam Early Access some point this year. I put this story in here just because, not so much because of the game itself, but what it means. Even though Stationeers actually looks really cool, it has this sort of chibi art style and, The zero gravity stuff looks really fun. Like, you know, it looks like a physics game meets, I don't want to say Minecraft, but definitely some sort of a crafting game. But this probably means that Dean Hall's Xbox One exclusive Ion is dead. Last week we heard from two separate developers that the game was no longer in development, which seemed kind of sketchy. Like, oh, so is this over? Is it done? And now Dean Hall, less than a month later, is back and he's like, hey, here's my next game. And it's not Ion. It's Stationeers, so you can add Ion to the list of canceled Xbox One exclusives. It's kind of pressing. Anyway, a sad toot toot. Let's talk about the games that are going to be coming out this week on Tuesday. Persona 5 will launch on the PlayStation 4 and the PlayStation 3. Yeah, really, we're getting a new PlayStation 3 game, and it's a really big deal. Persona 5 only took them 9 years to make a follow-up to Persona 4. Good on them. Also, LEGO City Undercover will be on the PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and Nintendo Switch, which of course was originally a Wii U exclusive. Now you can play it everywhere. Also, Drawn to Death will be on the PlayStation 4 on Tuesday. It will be $20, or it'll be free if you have PlayStation Plus. Sniper Ghost Warrior 3 will be on the PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and PC. Parappa the Rappa Remastered will be on the PlayStation 4. I really wish I had time to play that. I will have to check that out later. I still play my original copy of Parappa the Rappa from the PlayStation 1, and they even have a wall poster that actually came with the game. So, I'm kind of hardcore when it comes to Nana Ancha. On Wednesday, you can play Blackwood Crossing on the PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and PC, and on Friday, Bulletstorm Full Clip Edition will launch on the PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and PC. That, of course, is just a remastering of the original Bulletstorm that was out on the Xbox 360 and PlayStation 3, though this time, you can play as Duke Nukem. Cool, huh? Beep, beep. That's gonna do it for the hype train. Good old hype train. Love that hype train. Let's cut out the fluff. We need to go outside. I know a place that's always warm with the glow of cold hard cash. That's right, it's time for the Chart Park, the land where money grows on trees. Yes, the Chart Park. This is the part of the show where we talk about the legal, business, and financial news in the video game industry, and we find out which fat cats of Wall Street will dip their top hats towards Lady Luck. After 28 years in the business, accessory manufacturer Mad Catz is closing its doors. Last week, the company announced it had filed a voluntary petition for relief under Chapter 7 bankruptcy with intentions to begin liquidation of its assets. Mad Catz saw a series of unprofitable ventures since the turn of the decade, including their plastic instruments for Rock Band 4 and the underwhelming Mojo Android micro console. Does anyone even own a Mojo? Seriously, let me know if you own a Mojo. I want to know. I don't want to know if you own a micro console. I don't care if you got an Ouya. I don't care if you got an Nvidia Shield. I want to know if you own a goddamn Mojo. Let me know. Last year, the company slashed its workforce by 37%, including the loss of its CEO, chairman, and vice president of business affairs. So things were already kind of looking rough. In an effort to restabilize, Mad Catz sold its, I believe it was called Cytech flight stick simulation brand to Logitech, but still continued to struggle despite the sale. Last month, the New York Stock Exchange began delisting procedures for the company after its stock fell to 8 cents a share. 8 cents a share. Holy shit. Things were not looking good for Mad Catz already, and now they are gone. But Mad Catz was best known for their genre-specific accessories, including racing wheels, fight sticks, and, you know, generic controllers for consoles and PCs. But it's the end of an era. Even if it's not all that surprising, it's sad to see Mad Catz go, because they are a name that has been around for so long, and it feels like almost everyone has owned at least one Mad Catz controller. They were never any good, they were always kind of clunky, and they usually broke after about 5 hours of use, but, you know, it was a controller, I guess. You know, I've been covering this whole Mad Catz situation over the past 2 years, and every single development, not one of them, was encouraging. Every single time there was a bit of news about Mad Catz, it was always like, oh, so you lost all your top brass, and you're losing a third of your employees, and now the New York Stock Exchange is going to delist you, and you are investing in Rock Band? I'm actually surprised they lasted this long. You know, frankly, accessories are a bad idea in 2017. Look what happened to Toys to Life. Disney, big old Disney, big company, they got out of accessories like Toys to Life after Infinity Taint. Last year, Skylanders had abysmal sales. I can't imagine that Activision, you know, was happy with what they saw. I'm talking like 200,000 units per console. That is not a viable strategy, because the development to each console takes a lot of time and resources. Even Ubisoft, when they released Just Sing, you know, it was a singing game. It came with a phone app instead of a microphone. They didn't even include a microphone for a singing game, because they're like, whatever, you want a phone. Why should we buy microphones for you? Just deal with this instead. Hardware is expensive, and it is high risk. Just look at THQ. They were doing so well. They had things like Darksiders. They had things like Saints Row. But they invested a lot of their money in UDraw, which of course had a little tablet that you drew pictures on, and that destroyed the company. That one game, that one accessory-driven game, ruined the company. But that's not to say that accessories are completely dead. Razer and Corsair will survive, because they are mostly exclusively working on PC stuff. And PC does not have like a uniform keyboard or a mouse. And everything sort of fits to a different person. One person might want to have, you know, 15 buttons on the side of their mouse because they're playing a lot of MMOs, whereas someone wants something more streamlined and just smooth. You know, it's all about preference. There's no uniform hardware when it comes to PC. Hell, I mean, you can have a totally different chipset, you know? And I should point out that there are other people that are selling accessories right now. Even GameStop does a great job when they sell accessories for the PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. It just so happens that the accessories that they're selling are, you know, first party. Ones that are made by Sony, ones that are made by Microsoft. I mean, honestly, why would you ever buy a third-party controller for a console in this day and age? Especially with the DualShock 4 basically fixing all the problems with the DualShock 3. You know, the Xbox One controller having that amazing rumble in the triggers. And yes, I do mean amazing. It's fantastic. If you're playing a racing game, it feels so good. I assume other, you know, accessory makers like Hori are going to be fine, because they are actually sort of connected with first-party, you know, companies. I own a Fight Stick by Hori for the PlayStation 4, and you can barely tell that they made it. It looks like PlayStation made it. Look up all of these Nintendo Switch accessories that just came out. You might assume that Nintendo made those accessories, but if you look closely, it's actually Hori. They are very closely connected to first-party, you know, manufacturers, because they make really good quality stuff. But if you're another company like, I don't know, Nyko, you better stay small, and you better stay nimble, and you better be careful, because one bad bet might make you go under. And if you're thinking that, you know, there's one more company I would be worried about, and that's PDP, formerly Pelican. They should be extremely worried, because right now, guess what they're doing? Guess what they're investing their time and money into? They're making guitar accessories for Rock Band. Wow, it worked out so well for Mad Catz. But yes, RIP Mad Catz, you will be missed. Goodbye. But speaking of Rock Band, Harmonix recently laid off 17 of their employees. The company announced in a statement last week, quote, "Today we made the difficult decision to say goodbye to 17 talented people as we restructured to align with our current and anticipated development needs. These people all played a role in making Harmonix and its games what they are today, and we are more than grateful for their contributions. We are working to ensure that they are taken care of as we make this change," end quote. Harmonix has significantly shrunk in size following the company becoming independent in December of 2010. Since then, Harmonix received lukewarm sales for its previously popular Rock Band and Dance Central franchises. And that's basically the whole story right there. Harmonix is losing more employees, which has really been the story of Harmonix since, you know, they went independent from, I want to say it was Viacom. Viacom owned them, and then they bought themselves out. There's even rumors that they bought themselves out for as little as $50. I have no reason to believe that's true, but it's just a really odd story that just happens to exist. Maybe it is true. I don't know. I've always been a huge fan of Harmonix. Huge! Huge fan! Cannot stress. I played Amplitude. I played Frequency. I played Guitar Hero. I actually was counting down the days to the original Guitar Hero. When no one else was talking about Guitar Hero, I was excited for Guitar Hero. And I actually looked up online. Back in the day, you could actually kind of really go through a store's stock. I found one Best Buy that had it, right? And so I drove down there. And here's the thing that most people forget about the original Guitar Hero. It was delayed by 2 weeks. It was meant to come out one day, and then it got delayed by 2 weeks because they were trying to make sure they had enough stock because they had a feeling that the game was going to sell well. I showed up, and I was like, hey, can I get that? And they scan it, and the computer's like, oh, this isn't out for 2 more weeks. I'm like, yeah, but look. And there's a big sticker on there that says, you know, it's supposed to be out by so-and-so date. So I got a copy of Guitar Hero with the controller before almost anybody else. I immediately took it to a buddy's place because I already knew it was going to be great because it was Harmonix, and Harmonix made great games. And he's like, this is the lamest shit I have ever seen. I'm like, ah, come on, just give it a try. Puts it on. Wow, that was awesome. He goes to that Best Buy, he buys a copy, and he comes back. So now we're having already like a Rock Band style party with Guitar Hero. We're both jamming out with our guitars, and someone else shows up. And they're like, what are you guys doing? And this guy's a guitar player. He plays guitar, and he's really good at it. He likes to play speed metal, but he also knows how to play classic, guitar. And he's like, this is lame as fuck. Hey, man, give it a try. He puts it on. An hour later, he's at that Best Buy, also buying a copy of the game, and then, you know, we're taking turns playing Guitar Hero. It was amazing, and I felt so happy for Harmonix because they deserve that. And then Rock Band happened, and it was amazing, and Beatles Rock Band, one of my favorite games of all time, honestly changed my life, got me to go study music theory. Love Harmonix. So believe me that there's no ill will or malice from me when I say I have no idea how much longer Harmonix is going to be in business. And that sucks to say. But look at their business strategy. Every game that they're producing is centered around accessories, which, as we just discussed, not a good market to be in, and licensed music. You know, music they don't own. Music they have to pay for. Or music that is taking a cut out of their profits. They're still trying to get Rock Band going again. They're still trying to make it popular. I love Rock Band. I adore Rock Band. Rock Band is not popular. It will never be popular again. If it is, it will be a fluke. It will happen years from now. It will have absolutely nothing to do with these current attempts to bring back Rock Band. They released Rock Band 4. No one gave a shit. Now they have Rock Band Rivals. I'm sorry, do you guys... You heard about Rock Band Rivals, right? It just came out. Rock Band Rivals with the two guitars? You heard about that, right? You know what I'm talking about? Are you sure? No? It's because nobody cared. Nobody talked about Rock Band Rivals. Who gives a shit? It's over. No one wants that anymore. And now, right now, they are developing two VR games that absolutely do not need to be VR. There's Rock Band VR, which I think I should say again, Rock Band is not popular, and Sing Space, a Gear VR karaoke game. You know, where you take your phone, you plug it into the Gear VR, and you put it over your face. I can think of few things sadder than sitting in a room with your eyes covered, singing into your phone that's strapped to your face. It's a karaoke game. Why the hell does that need to be in VR? People are already self-conscious enough. Can you imagine singing while your eyes are covered? That is insanely stupid. Now, and here's the kicker right here. They have some sort of board game, or maybe it's a toy. I have no idea. It is called Drop Mix, where you put cards into this box and it remixes the music. And they're showing this trailer where it's just people dancing around this box. It's like four people in a room. It looks like a moment from The Sims. It does not look like reality, and yet these are real people. Who is that for? Kids that won't be listening to that music, or adults who would not even... What is the point of it? You just put cards in there and it remixes the music. I mean, it's a neat little gimmick, but it's a phone app. It doesn't need to have a physical box where you're putting cards in there. I just don't know. And like I said, all these projects, they include music. Harmonix doesn't own at all. They're paying for that. I wish they were successful, but I see no value in these upcoming projects. And I'm their audience. And I have no interest in one of them. Not one of them. That's terrifying. I really don't think we're going to see Harmonix around for much longer. I would not be surprised if somebody bought it, took the Rock Band name, just put out phone apps. Someone who actually knows what they're doing. And that sucks. That sucks so much. And whenever I say this, I always talk about when people are leaving a company and how it's going to affect a company. And people think it's because, oh, they were the ideas man, or, oh, they were, you know, whatever they think. I don't know. Whenever someone leaves a company, it changes it, because companies are cultures. They can be good cultures, they can be bad cultures, but they are, because there are people together. You right now, you are part of a culture at your workplace. Your workplace has a certain vibe, there are certain expectations, there are certain jokes, and that results in what you're producing, what you're working on, is from the people you're around. And Harmonix lost person after person after person, important people, and it shows in their work. It's sad, but I wish Harmonix could figure it out, to just stay the fuck away from accessories. If you're going to use licensed music, really be choosy about what you're using. Stop trying to chase after these radio hits. That's a lot of goddamn money. Anyway, moving on. Last week, the United Kingdom officially triggered Article 50, commonly known as Brexit. Yes, we're going to be talking about Brexit. Now, with the UK leaving the European Union, some of the developers in the UK are considering relocating. In a survey conducted by the Association for UK Interactive Entertainment, 23% of UK developers located inside the UK. Okay, that was sort of... I didn't need to say that twice, whatever. UK developers, 23% of them said they've already been offered a new headquarter in America or neighboring European countries. 9% did not respond. I guess maybe they just didn't have an answer. While 51% said they were committed to remaining inside of the UK. 38% of larger studios, we're talking about 38% of bigger studios, said their outside investments were negatively impacted by Brexit, while 60% of smaller studios also said they were experiencing similar difficulties, which is really depressing. Now look, I'm not here to talk about the merits of Brexit. I'm an American. I do not think that I have an opinion on Brexit. I don't feel like I should share it here. Because I hate when I'm listening to some British guy explain what's going on with the American politics. It's like, you don't know this. You know, it's obnoxious. So I'm not going to be talking about, is Brexit good or is it bad or whatever. But it is important to understand Brexit will result in serious changes for some UK developers. The European Union basically made it incredibly easy for non-UK residents to work inside the UK. And that includes video game developers. Now that's going to require a lot more work, possibly even immigrating to the UK, which as of right now, immigration is a little up in the air for that kingdom. Hey, by the way, do you call the UK a nation or a kingdom? I mean, I know they put kingdom in the name. I just don't know. Those added complications are already stressful enough for the individual, right? And like I said earlier about how everything affects a team, how everything creates a culture, losing people, or having people that are very stressful that they're going to get kicked out of the country, or having people that are stressed out about trying to get their immigration papers together, that's going to reflect on a project. And that really sucks. I mean, I guess maybe they could just work from home and email their work in, kind of like what you saw with Ori and the Blind Forest, but that's still going to impact the culture, because they're not there. They're not there to freely exchange ideas, to bounce around concepts, and that limits how much they can work as a unit. And some of their projects just will not be the same. That's sad. Anyway, moving on. The former face of VR technology, Palmer Luckey, has announced his departure from Facebook and the company he helped found, Oculus VR. In a statement to website GameSpot, Oculus confirmed the news, stating, quote, "Palmer will be dearly missed. Palmer's legacy extends far beyond Oculus. His inventive spirit helped kickstart the modern VR revolution and build an industry we're thankful for. Everything he did for Oculus and VR, and we wish him all the best." In his quick rise, Palmer Luckey went from an unknown developer to an entrepreneurial superstar, gracing the cover of Forbes and Time magazine, after selling Oculus to Facebook for just under $2 billion. However, his reputation took a major turn over the past several months as it was discovered Luckey was partially financing an anti-Hillary Clinton organization called Nimble America, whose activities became entwined with white supremacy and anti-Muslim immigration rhetoric. Following that, Luckey became a major factor in the lawsuit between Oculus and ZeniMax, where the prosecution repeatedly stated that Palmer was incapable of producing high-quality virtual reality, accusing him of stealing technology and software. ZeniMax was ultimately awarded $500 million, which probably has not been paid out yet, by the jury, with Luckey himself fined $50 million for false designation. Palmer Luckey was formerly active on social media for years, really, and has not made a public statement since his apology regarding Nimble America in September. Wow, I feel so bad for this guy. You have to. He's leaving his job, and now all he has is hundreds of millions of dollars and decades and decades and decades and decades of life left. Poor Palmer Luckey. Poor Palmer Luckey. He only has $700 million. Oh no, they're going to take $50 million away. He only has $600 million. Oh, Palmer Luckey. No, seriously. I'm just messing around. So place your bets. Did Oculus ask Palmer Luckey to leave, or did Palmer Luckey decide to leave on his own accord? We don't know the answer to that, and we probably won't know for some time, but it wouldn't surprise me if they asked him to leave, given that he's brought nothing but horrible, negative attention to the company and Facebook over the past 8 months. I mean, is he a white supremacist? I don't think so at all, but there is a vibe, there are opinions out there that now associate him with white supremacy. Not great for Facebook. Or maybe possibly, you know, did Palmer decide to quit on his own? Like I said, I don't know, but it wouldn't surprise me because he was a public guy. He liked to be on stage. He liked to discuss his technology with lots of people. He liked to go to the trade shows. He liked to shake hands. He liked to interact with people. And ever since the whole Nimble America thing, Facebook has tucked him away. They've kept him hidden, I assume. I assume that he wants to stay hidden himself. You know, he doesn't want to be out in the public that much. But I assume Facebook was like, "Oop, you're not going out there anymore. You were not representing this company we paid $2 billion for." But I imagine it wasn't very fun for him. You know, it's not the same. He used to be able to go everywhere and everybody treated him really nice. And he got to be the poster boy for technology he was very passionate about. But whatever you want to say about his political views or his business practices, he did this to himself. He made stupid mistakes, or at least I hope he understands that what he did were mistakes. I hope he understands that his sense of regret, and I hope he has a bit of regret, comes from guilt rather than just being caught. The act itself was bad, and he understands that. But he was, for whatever you think about him now, he was an important figure in popularizing VR. It's a nice story that some dude in his mid-20s revolutionized the technology. We want to believe in that something like that can happen. And that might just be a narrative that we all latched onto, but at that time, VR needed a figurehead. And it had one in Palmer Luckey. And that really made the difference. Now today, VR doesn't need a figurehead. And even if it did, neither Facebook or the general public would want it to be Palmer Luckey. Anyway, let's go on to some good news. And this is good news for streamers. Twitch has finally introduced 1080p and 60 frames per second streaming, upping its limited bit rate from 3.5 megabytes all the way up to 6 megabytes. That's almost double. Almost, but not really. I don't actually know what the math is on there. Users interested in these new features are encouraged to test their bandwidth with Twitch Inspector to make sure their current provider can maintain a stable stream. These updated options will roll out over the next few weeks, though Twitch did not mention if or when they will come to PlayStation 4 or Xbox One. Last week I was talking about how Facebook was getting into the live streaming game, and I thought it was awesome because I thought it would challenge Twitch. Now, I'm not saying that Facebook having that announcement is why we're getting this Twitch news this week, but I'm sure... Actually, I kind of am. I know they were probably developing 1080p, 60 frames per second all along. They always had plans to up their bandwidth, but maybe, you know, just maybe, Facebook encouraged them to actually work a little harder, you know? For the past... year or so, it feels like Twitch has been focusing on monetizing Twitch. Amazon especially has been trying to encourage them to figure out a way to make money off of this thing. And they focus so much on that, it really started to affect the quality of the streaming. You go over to YouTube, you can stream 1080p, 60 frames per second, no problem. You could do that for a very, very long time. Twitch is just getting around to it. And that's just because they were focused in the wrong direction. Yes, it's really important that they make money, but you also need to cater to the people that already use your service. I'm also really curious to see if... I know that if you use a PlayStation 4 Pro, you can stream to YouTube 60 frames per second, 1080p. I'd be really, really curious to see if that works for Twitch in the near future for the PlayStation 4 Pro, and assume that it will happen with the Scorpio as well, whenever that is released. Regardless, it's clear Twitch is trying to match their competitors, and the more that they increase their quality, the more that Facebook and Google will need to increase their quality. And at the end of the day, that means that everyone that wants to stream wins out. So it's good news. Hooray. Moving on. Our next story is about Final Fantasy XIV, Daddy of Light. I'm serious. We are talking about something called Final Fantasy XIV, Daddy of Light. Daddy of Light! This is a Japanese television drama about a son encountering his real-world father in an MMO, the MMO being Final Fantasy XIV, and the relationship develops, though the father is completely unaware that his fellow player is his son. The show was apparently popular enough to garner a US release via Netflix this fall. Yep. Machinima and Daddy issues. Moving on. In some positive news, digital game revenue has saw some impressive growth. According to the analyst site Superdata, global digital sales grew by 4% in the month of February. Overall, digital sales, 4% increase. Though the highest grossing titles largely remained the same, there were a few newcomers, including For Honor, on consoles. Not much else to say about this story, but digital sales are growing, as is DLC, and the more people become accustomed to downloading DLC or downloading a patch or downloading whatever, I think the worse it is for GameStop. People are kind of getting into the groove, being like, whatever, I already have to download this stuff anyway, why don't I just download the game, and that way I don't have to go to some store. So, makes sense why it was up 4%. Also, maybe that just means that more people have consoles, more people have PCs, more people have gift cards. Maybe that's what it was. Although, I guess it should have impacted January as well. I don't know. Whatever. Let's talk about the top 10 games that were sold this week in the UK. These are the 10 best-selling games in the UK for the past week. Number 10 was Forza Horizon 3. Number 9 was Call of Duty Infinite Warfare. Number 8 was Rocket League. Number 7 was FIFA 17. Number 6 was The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild on the Switch, I assume? Maybe they combined all the sales. I'm actually not positive. Number 5 was Grand Theft Auto 5. Oof! I love it when the numbers match up like that. Number 4 was Horizon Zero Dawn. Number 3 was Lego Worlds. Number 2 was Ghost Recon Wildlands. And number 1 in its debut week was Mass Effect Andromeda. Yes, it was the number 1 selling game, though apparently sales for it are down compared to Mass Effect 3. just worth noting. Now let's go over to the cursed land of trains, known as Japan, to find out one of the 10 best-selling games of the past week in Japan. Number 10 was The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild on the Wii U. Number 9 was Nier Automata on the PlayStation 4. Number 8 was Kingdom Hearts HD 1.5 plus 2.5 Remix on the PlayStation 4. Number 7 was Excel World vs. Sword Art Online on the PlayStation Vita. Number 6 was Pokemon Sun and Moon on the 3DS. Number 5 was Horizon Zero Dawn, still doing really well in Japan, and that makes me happy. Only sold around 12,000 copies, but that's still pretty cool. That was number 5. Number 4 was Ghost Recon Wildlands on the PlayStation 4. Number 3 was... Number 3 was 1-2 Switch. Nintendo Switch. What are you doing, Japan? What are you doing? Do you not know better? Do you not... First you buy that goddamn 3DS Mario Maker, now you're buying 1-2 Switch. In droves. Third best-selling game in the entire country. Get a hold of yourself. God damn it. Number 2 was The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild on the Nintendo Switch. And number 1 was Monster Hunter XX on the 3DS, because god damn it, that is just the biggest thing ever over there, is Monster Hunter. Those sales are still down compared to other games, even though they sold 280,000 copies in just 1 week. Now let's talk about where the best-selling consoles over in Japan, starting out with the Nintendo Switch with 78,441, new 3DS LL with 29,771, PlayStation 4 with 25,472, PlayStation Vita with 7,574, 2DS with 6,722, PlayStation 4 Pro with 5,261, PlayStation 3 with 2,930, new 3DS with 2,866, Wii U with 411, and in last place for the fourth week in a row is the Xbox One with 115. Just keep trying, Microsoft. Come on. The Wii U is going to slip up one of these days, and then it's all going to be yours, baby. It's all going to be yours. But that's going to have to do it for the Chart Park, the land where money grows on trees. Ooh, I think I got a tan from the Chart Park. Ooh. Anyway, we talked about the big money. Now we need to talk about the smaller things. That's right, it's time to get tiny. It's time for Pocket Talk, Pocket Talk, Pocket Talk. If you've ever wanted to take part in an ancient Chinese war but are intimidated by square buttons, you're in luck. Koei Tecmo has launched Dynasty Warriors Unleashed on iOS and Android stores. Yes, I'm proud of that joke, and no, I shouldn't be. In this isolated brawler, players will smash their way through historic fights with touch buttons. The game is free, though it does include a smattering of paid items. You know, I watched the video of this game, and it does have some fairly impressive graphics for a phone title. I believe I saw footage from a Samsung Galaxy S7 Edge, which is a more powerful phone, and it looked good, but the actual gameplay seemed a bit bare bones. And I mean, you know, Dynasty Warriors is great, despite its limited complexity, despite the fact that you're just smash, 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 smash. And it works because there's just enough to it. But if you take away a third of the dimension of the game, where now it's basically like an isometric kind of a 2D, even though it has 3D graphics game, I think it's going to kind of ruin it. You know, that's kind of the cool thing about Dynasty Warriors, is even though it's you know, it's really repetitive, like, running into a base feels like something, because it's a 3D environment. I don't know. Maybe it's just me. Anyway, let's move on to the next story. It's rare that mobile games receive an announcement trailer before their release, but Ubisoft is breaking the mold with their new phone title. Shadow Break is a real-time multiplayer sniper shooter game. That's really what they're calling it, I don't know what that means, where players will scout an environment with their scope and guide a squad of soldiers through a dangerous operation and, of course, pick off enemies to aid their progress. No release date was given, though it's currently available in Canada, for some reason, before it will roll out to the rest of the world some point later this year. So right now, all we have is a really generic CG trailer and a couple of screenshots, but this sounds like an amazing concept. Like, this doesn't just sound like a good, you know, phone concept. This sounds like a great PC and console game. Like, I love that idea of just using your scope to be like, oh, go through this door, and you're making sure that they're not going to get killed. That's exciting. That's awesome. You know, normally I'd be a bit skeptical about a mobile game, but the fact that Ubisoft actually took the time to produce a trailer before the game is coming out, because most of the time it's just like, oh, the game is out, enjoy, and then they run away. They actually produced a trailer for this and, like, get excited. This game's going to be cool. This shows that they have faith in Shadowbreak. And I, too, will have faith in Shadowbreak. Don't break my heart, Ubisoft. But that's going to have to do it for Pocket Talk. Pocket Talk, Pocket Talk. Let's take the mushroom. Anyway, we have finally come to the final segment of the Pressure Cast, where we take a look back at the week that was 10 years ago and beyond to discover the anniversaries and events in something we like to call Strong History. 10 years ago, on the PlayStation 3, Enhanced Arms was released. Cool little RPG, if I'm remembering that correctly. Early RPG for the PlayStation 3. I believe it was only, yeah, it had to be, only around less than 6 months after the console launched. And people were looking for some meaty games, so a lot of people picked up Enhanced Arms. Also 10 years ago, on the Xbox 360, Guitar Hero 2 launched on the system. And this was a huge deal because unlike the PlayStation 2 release, Guitar Hero 2 on the 360 included a wireless guitar. And I believe it was like a Flying V. It was like a white Flying V guitar controller. I know a lot of people definitely played that game on the Xbox 360 and considered it to be the best version. And then they would follow it up with Guitar Hero 3. And I feel like that was when the franchise really hit its peak. You know, Guitar Hero in general. 11 years ago, The Elder Scrolls Oblivion Horse Armor Pack DLC was launched. Yes, 11 years ago, DLC became a dirty word when Bethesda was attempting to charge for horse armor, which I don't believe really did anything in the game. I mean, it added armor onto your horse. Was it worth $5 or $3, whatever they charged? Definitely not. I think this is really when the worm turned for DLC, and whenever people saw something they didn't like, they would just call it horse armor. 12 years ago, on the PlayStation 2, LEGO Star Wars was released. Yes, 12 years ago, the LEGOs, the current incarnation, I should say, of LEGO games really kicked off. And they really haven't changed that much, even with the latest LEGO Worlds. You're still holding down triangle to open up your item wheel, and you're still building blocks really fast. It's kind of amazing that that whole system is held up and still sells really well. Also, 12 years ago, on the original Xbox, Doom 3 was launched. And this was a huge deal because Doom 3 was the reason to own a PC, and people said it would never work on consoles. What they didn't know is that there was actually some pretty good NVIDIA technology inside the original Xbox, and Doom 3, for what it was, ran really well on the system. Is it better than the PC version? No, not even close, but it was impressive, and it did have online multiplayer, which I don't believe was actually in the PC version. So go figure. Also 12 years ago on the PlayStation 2, Rise of the Kasai, the sequel to Mark of Kree. This is a game that nobody ever talks about, which is the only reason I mention it here. Look it up. It's kind of interesting. 13 years ago on the PlayStation 2 and Xbox, Fight Night 2004 was launched, the very first entry in the amazing Fight Night series. This game, for its time, was kind of cool, but it does not hold up. Namely because you cannot move and punch at the same time. And if you can't move and punch at the same time in the real world of boxing, you're going to get knocked the fuck out. I guess unless you're Butterbean and you're boxing a couple of tin cans. But Fight Night in 2004 was really revolutionary because it included analog stick punching. You had to tap the button, tap the analog stick up to do a jab, and then slightly to the left to do a hook, and then all the way down to do an uppercut. It was a revolutionary system, and it's a shame we don't see that in more games to this day. I mean, come on. We got two analog sticks. Let me do something besides control a camera. Jerks. 14 years ago on the PlayStation 2, Tom Clancy's Splinter Cell was released. Why are we talking about the PlayStation 2 release of Tom Clancy's Splinter Cell? Well, that was because when it launched on the original Xbox, people said, there's no way this will ever come to PS2. It looks too damn good. It's impossible. But you know what? Ubisoft pulled it off. Did it look as good as the Xbox version? Once again, hell no. But it looked really good. Good on them for pulling it off. Also, 14 years ago, I'm getting the vapors right here. Death Jam Vendetta was released. And in case you don't know, Death Jam Vendetta featured a bunch of just, I would say, rappers and hip-hop personalities. And the original game was a wrestling game. Actually, was this the wrestling game? This was the wrestling game. I almost got twisted here. This is a wrestling game that has just almost everyone from Wu-Tang is in it. You can actually have a tag team with Method Man and Red Man, and it was just awesome. It was actually made by Aki, the people that made the wrestling games WrestleMania 2000 and No Mercy. If you like those games and you're like, whatever happened to those guys? They made some incredible hip-hop infused wrestling games. Although I would say between the two, you want to check out the sequel, Def Jam Fight for New York, which is sort of more of an MMA style game. where you can just throw someone in front of a train and murder them. So it's kind of like Mortal Kombat meets pro wrestling meets hip hop. It's amazing. Oh, and Henry Rollins is in it if you're into metal and punk. So you got that going for you. 16 years ago, we talk about just like going from amazing to shit. On the original PlayStation, 16 years ago, The Simpsons Wrestling. Now, keep in mind, The Simpsons never had a good video game outside of the incredible arcade title way back in the late 80s, early 90s by Konami. Was it 1990? Maybe 91? Konami put that out. Amazing beat 'em up. It was excellent, even though it really didn't get a lot of the parts of the show right, including Smithers' voice not being right, and same with Mr. Burns. It's really bizarre, but almost every Simpsons game has sucked. I guess you could say, some of those games on the PlayStation 2, like Road Rage and things like that. Those are okay. They're okay. Okay. Barely passable. The Simpsons Wrestling is one of the worst games I've ever seen or played. It's an embarrassment. It's awful. You just play as random Simpsons characters and you just mash buttons. There's no wrestling. I mean, you're not even going to scoop slam anybody. How the fuck is that a pro wrestling game? Instead, you're just punching and kicking and it's just mushy and loose. How can you be mushy and loose? I don't know, but The Simpsons Wrestling pulls it off, and it is crap. So let's get away from that. 19 years ago, on the Neo Geo, Metal Slug 2 was launched. Fantastic game. And I believe you can get some of the Metal Slug games on the Nintendo Switch. So if you own one of those and you want to check it out, you can have it on the go, or you can have it on your TV on the Nintendo Switch. And it is a good port, because the ports were done by Hamster, and they're great. 21 years ago, on the Sega Saturn, X-Men Children of the Atom was launched. If you played this on the PlayStation 2 and you thought it was okay, but not that great of a fighting game, that's because you were playing it on the PlayStation. If you play it on the Saturn, which had the 4 megabit expansion, you could make the game run way faster. There was hardly any loading. It was an amazing 2D fighter featuring all the characters from the X-Men, and they were basically just totally represented by their cartoon incarnations from the early 90s, because over in Japan, they fucking love that cartoon. So X-Men, Throne of the Atom, if you got a Sega Saturn, that's the way to play it, unless you got an arcade cabinet. Do you think we'll ever get a re-release of that? That'd be cool. Probably not. I wish we would, though. Because, you know, Disney and Fox or whatever. Okay. 25 years ago, Minesweeper was launched on the PC, which many, many, many bored people have used to pass the time on their personal computer. 27 years ago, on the TurboGrafx-16 in Japan, Splatterhouse was launched, one of the, one of the first great horror games. Basically, you played as a guy that was wearing a hockey mask, but totally wasn't Jason, as he searched around a spooky mansion for his girlfriend. And let me tell you, this is one of those games where it's almost like God of War or Bayonetta, even though it's a 2D game. What I'm trying to say is it's one of those games where by the end of the game, you're like, man, they really shouldn't mess with this guy. Because in Splatterhouse, you're walking around as this guy, I forget his name, but he looks like Jason, and he's just batting people into walls, and their bodies are just exploding into blood. He's just using shotguns. Like, if you're a demon, do not mess with that guy. Come on, use your brain. Maybe demons aren't that smart. I don't know. 29 years ago, in Japan, some really bad games were launched. Double Dragon on the NES. Or I guess it was the Famicom, because it was Japan. Some people will tell you that Double Dragon was a good game. It wasn't. Double Dragon 2 was a great game. Double Dragon 1, lots of horrible platforming. Just garbage. Also, in Japan this week, Garfield no Inshukan, A Week of Garfield, where you played as Garfield walking around his house in an incredibly shitty platformer. Horrible. And finally, this week over in Japan, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde was launched on the Famicom. And they took one look at that game and said, we could totally release this in the United States, I don't see why not. One of those games that proves the Nintendo seal of quality was a goddamn lie. Also, 31 years ago, and this is actually really cool news, 31 years ago, this week, Atlus was formed. The company was formed. They are putting out a little game called Persona 5 this Tuesday. It's kind of cool. It's right around their anniversary, 31 years ago. Just a really awesome studio that made some amazing JRPGs. And that's about it. They really only work in JRPGs, but who cares? When they're of that quality, it's hard to complain. And 42 years ago, and finally for strong history, William H. Gates III and Paul G. Allen formed a company called Microsoft in Albuquerque, New Mexico. They only had 3 employees. That'll probably never pan out. But yes, Microsoft, happy birthday. You went from a little company in a garage to controlling the motherfucking planet. That's kind of remarkable. But that's also going to have to do it for Strong History. Good week. Good week. Well, this show is a bit shorter than usual because, hey, there wasn't that much news. I tried my hardest. But what are you going to do? It sounds like I'm apologizing for the show. But man, now is the time where we need to close up the show. Remember, you can follow me on Twitter at Dr. Crychop. That's at Dr. Crychop. You can follow the Pressure Cast at VGADum on Twitter. Or go to the Facebook. Go to Facebook.com/VGADum. It's going to be a busy week. I'm going to get an episode of Worth It Out, an impressions video all about Persona 5. Hopefully I'll have that up by Thursday, I hope, because on Friday I'm going to be heading down to the Midwest Gaming Classic to go and interview a bunch of people and hang out with those guys from Portables of Doom and hang out with the guys from Newt Industries. It's going to be a fantastic time. It might be my favorite time of the year, so I'm really hyped for that, and I'm going to have a ton of interviews, a ton of videos that will be going out in the next weeks and months to come, so please come back and watch those, because they're always, no one watches the interviews, but they're so good. These people take their time out of their day to sit down and talk with me, and they always bring their A game. Maybe I don't bring my A game. I try my best to interview people, but they definitely bring their A game. But other than that, nothing else is really going on. Mad Cats, it's gone. It's dead forever. And that's sad. But hey, what are you going to do? They made a lot of really bad accessories. And some good accessories. But there's no market for that anymore. But the Pressure Cast will never end. Because the Pressure Cast doesn't make accessories. And it is forever. Bye, everybody.